Yes. Okay. Okay. Luke is there. I see Alex. Alex, also there.
Good morning.
Good morning, Ryan. Well, I the only one I don't know is Taylor. How are you? Nice to meet you.
Pleasure to meet you as well, Oscar.
Thank you. Well, we are a bit belated, but we can start. And my name is Oscar Garcia. Some of you know me already from the IPNSIG, the Planetary Networking Special Interest Group. I am the Pilot Project Working Group Lead. I am trying to set up my camp. Can you see me well?
Okay. Yes, you're coming clear.
Okay, perfect. Well, thanks to Dr. Bull that has invited me to this class give you a lecture about the DTN. I think you all are more or less involved at this time with the interplanetary internet because Ronnie Bull has been with us working for some months, and he has a background in DTN for several years. I'm going to give you first an idea of the small history of the DTN, of the IPNSIG. And after that, we are going to talk about the testing plan and the work of the project working group that we have been developing for some time. I'm going to share my screen now. I'm looking for my screen sharing. I can see that. I can see that now, cannot see that now. Participants chat.
Oh, you don't have a screen share?
Okay, there I got it. Fantastic. Well, let's see if I can share what I want to, because this Google has, this Zoom has it specifically ways of doing things. Let's see if this works. I have the lounge here.
Something is happening.
Oh, all the time is something is happening. You never know what. Okay, let's see. Do you see my Google Chrome?
No. I just see, there it is. Yes, yep. Yes.
Okay, can you see my presentation?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, perfect, fantastic. The incredible things of computing. Okay, first of all, my presentation I almost did. This is our class of the special topic of interplanetary internet prototype network. On September 30, 2021, my name is Oscar Garcia. I am the pilot project working group lead of the interplanetary network special interest group. Are you seeing are you seeing the mission, IPNSIG mission?
Yes.
Oh, perfect. Well, we are there. Well, the Interplanetary Networking Special Interest Group was set up with the idea to realize a functional and scalable system for interplanetary data communications. And I'm going to give a short idea of the evolution of DTN. I asked Mr. Vinton Cerf, that I guess all of you know, he was the creator with Bokano of the TCP/IP protocol, and is so-called one of the fathers of the internet. And well, we talk with Dinton frequently, so I ask him of these slides to present to you. The DTN was started several years ago. This is one idea of the internet of a solar system internet that we are working in the IPNSIG. At first, you might know that the TCP/IP was the starting internet that was the ARPANET at a certain time in 1977. It was different networks that were connecting between themselves. And at the time, there were different protocols that were in a certain way of saying they were trying to be more important one from the other. Finally, the TCP/IP and started one of the concepts that I'm surely you know is that to connect different kinds of networks like what we now call Wi-Fi, like satellite networks and like wire networks. This kind of three different networks at some point before that were not able to connect between themselves, and the TCP/IP allowed that. Now the internet is this big thing that is all spread around the world. And we started to, one of the problems when the interplanet, the space exploration started was the difficulty to connect between long distances. The long distances has the problem, the TCP/IP works pretty well in situations where you have a good permanent connection between the different endpoints. So when you send, like we call a packet, a bunch of bytes from one end to the other, then if you have a good connection, the packet reaches this destiny, but if the connections drops, you have the TTL, the time to leave. So all the packet dies in some way or the other. So when the problem when this space exploration started was to reach and to keep the connectivity in some way or the other between so distant endpoints with so big distance and in terms of light speed with a long time to get the connectivity. At that time, there started some ideas that you may know or you may remember that these rovers that were used in the first rovers in Mars, the Opportunity, the Curiosity, this small robot rovers with wheels and all that were, well, the idea was they could connect with the Earth and to get the information back here to our world. So the initial points were, well, use TCP/IP, the problem was what we have talked about. Between, for example, Mars and Earth, you have between 7 or 40 minutes, depending on the orbits. The flow controls of TCP/IP doesn't work so well in that kind of situation. The DNS lookup is not really so possible at that point. So the idea for a delay and disruption tolerant network started. And one of the situations was to bundle, in a certain way, get all the information into one bundle to send all together from one point to the other. The idea was to delay the resolution of the different names and addresses, and also to store temporarily these bytes, making now into a bundle in intermediate parts of the networks until they reach their destiny. I'm not going to stand very much on all this. In 1998, a small group started with Adrian Cook, Scott Burley, that was, and Nick Torkelson, and Kate Scott, they all work with us in the IPNSIG. So I think it's very interesting also for you in your career, because the IPNSIG has the founders, the founders of the DDN technology. When the first rovers started connecting from Mars, well, there was some problems because the radios that were used to make this connection overheated because of the excessive demand that they had from to get that information one way or the other. Well, over the years, another processes had been developing to make this connectivity more reliable, and it started also an organization, a global organization between the different space agencies too, that is called the CSCS, to establish in some way a way of establishing certain rules to allow connectivity between the different endpoints of different sources and different origins and different countries. You can take notes if you wish to. Afterwards, we can talk about each point that arises your interest. The contact graph routing is also an important topic that we have been working with Dr. Bull in the last months, and we other members of IPNSIG. Well, here are some of the images of the different devices and spacecraft that have been traveling on space and started to use DDN. The refining and testing have been gone over since 2008. Has been used also in not only in as radio space communications, but also in has been tested over light laser connections, and we are also in a project to make this work as a testing with the IPNSIG and NASA in the next months. There have been robotic operations, lunar laser demonstrations with light, as I was telling you before. The interoperability testing is one of the topics that is very important, because the DDN and the banded protocol implementations have different versions or implementation from different sources, because one of the ideas is that it's an open protocol that all the specifications are set up in the IETF. Dr. Bull and myself are members of the working group, and others members of the PWG are also members. The idea is that different implementation from different persons or different countries can connect and send messages and get information connecting with each other, which is very important because at some point, if we are going to have Mars or we have to have the moon and we are going to have Earth or Venus or different planets or spacecraft, well, they would need to connect even to send SOS if they need help. So that's why we're talking about. We are talking about real applications. Well, there have been several projects over the years. So I don't want to be extensive. Here is another point interesting that, and I'm going to mention later, I was one of the, that we made a connection between different architectures in Google Cloud that allowed DTN to be, these versions to be connecting between the clouds. And we are also been working in connections with satellites and satellites to cloud. So that's quite a landscape. Well, and from Vinton's idea, from Vinton's surf idea, this and this is one of the models that could happen in 2026 of the interplanetary of a first step of an interplanetary or solar system internet, where we would like to establish communications between all the spacecrafts and the different planets and the moon and all that. Thank you to Vinton. I shared this with Vinton yesterday for him to know. And after that, well, at the IPNSIG, we are part of the, I'm going to make a short description for you of the Interplanetary Networking Special Interest Group. I personally got involved into this because in ICANN, perhaps you know, ICANN is the Internet Corporation of Assigned Names and Numbers. It's one of the governing organizations in the internet that, and I was the local host in Mar del Plata, my city, and I started talking with Vinton about interplanetary networking. I've been involved with the medical records area for 21 years now, and we developed a technology that has an idea of the DTN model. Because when you need medical records, you cannot rely on that the internet is available. If the internet is down, then the doctor doesn't have the information that he needs to give care to the patient. So we started talking about that with Vinton. Those are a picture of Vinton and myself. And we had developed a technology, but based in TCP/IP that was quite useful and had quite a glimpse of DTN. So we were in the same mind track. The IPNSIG, that's why how I started with that and with this. And the IPNSIG was founded in the year 2002, this is the timeline of the different, consider that in 1997, 1998, this conversation was started. So in 2002, the IPNSIG was founded as an organization between the scope of the internet society that could help to develop not only from the governments, but also from a civilian point of view, from a citizen point of view, the development of the interplanetary networking. So the IPNC has 800 global participants, more than that, 800 something. In several, as you can see, in several continents, North America, Africa, Asia Pacific, Latin America, Europe, Middle East. We have several working groups, strategy, outreach, also documentation, and pilot projects. That's the group that I led. We are now launching the architecture and governance working group, because sooner or later, you know that all these kind of things need a governance structure to make it reliable and could work in time. And well, of course, there are business ideas and all that. There are working groups in all these topics at this point. Also, the IPNC has launched this strategy report that I'm going to send. Ronnie, I don't know if you have the link, or I'm going to send it out to the different to the members attending. This strategy is toward a solar system internet for humanity. This is a starting roadmap that it is our idea, and we are now talking with the different space agencies and also with the companies to try to, in a certain way, move forward with all these ideas in the scope or with the goal of establishing this network. This down now, we are going. We are part of the pilot project working group, which I lead, and Dr. Bull and other members are part, and some of the students have attended. One of the things that we have done. I'm going to very fast with this. We have done the first DTVN communication between servers. That was last year, in last November, between Amazon Web Service and Google Cloud. We send bundles back and forth and make this kind of connection with Larissa Suzuki, with an engineer in Google London, and myself and Dr. Surf. We are also developed with members of our group this DTN work network management. I guess you all have at this point worked with ION, as I've been told by Dr. Bull, trying to establish this connection. You know, you have to build all these networking maps that perhaps they are quite complicated sometimes until you get used to do that. This is a tool that has been built with the idea to make this easier. There are also other experiments. We have a group that are members also of our working group that are in Sweden, for example, working in the Arctic, because DTN, our idea is also to test DTN in Earth environment, so to make it reliable. And this has been a very good opportunity for these members that have been working in this. They are following these herds of reindeers in the middle of the Arctic with DTN, so the connectivity is very, very complicated. You have a lot of ice there. This is quite a space situation in some ways that is one of the ideas and can be very helpful to us. And this is one of the developments, my development, because as I told you before, I've been in medical records for many years, and I developed the UNIFE medical record for space exploration that is connecting all the medical records in the Earth with the different sources, with the different companies that have medical record system, with DTN technology and a gateway that I built and with my team, and that could be connected through DTN to space exploration, for space tourism. And this is working and was presented last year in the Space Terrestrial Workshop, Internet Working Workshop, and also was nominated in the Arthur C. Clarke Award from the British Interplanetary Society. So we are very happy about that. These are some of the projects. Also, another project that we developed this year was the connectivity with one of the European Space Agency satellites using DTN, and two different implementations of DTN. One from the ION DTN, that is the derived from what NASA is using, and the DTN, that is a version that is originating in Germany. And that's one very important point. And in the middle also, we included the interpretation of images with Google artificial intelligence. So this is what sending images from the satellite going down to Earth, connecting through ION, going back to Earth through D3DN, connected through ION, being interpreted by the AI from Google, and then going back to space, and then the result received in Europe. So it was quite a complicated round trip. Well, this is a brief of the research experiments. One of the projects is very connected to Utica, because this is the second is interoperability, connecting several DTN implementations that I'm sure Dr. Bull has been working with you in these ideas. Well, we are working in routing and security. One of the topics that I am very involved and excited is interfacing DTN with different languages, programming languages, to develop applications. We're going to talk about the global testing plan. The applications, beside medical record, there is a first responder system in development with drones and DTN, because you know, when you have a big crisis or catastrophic situation, what happens is that the communications goes down. So DTN is also very useful in that kind of situations. Well, finally, we're going to talk, we're moving forward up to talk at, to the testing plan that we have developed with several members. We launched that with Dr. Bull in the IGF meeting, the Internet Engineering Task Force 111 last July, with the motto, test the interplanetary internet at home before you go to space. What's the idea with this? What we want to do is to establish, determinate reliability of the different protocols, of the different internet protocols, of the different, DTN protocols. And because as you may imagine, all these protocols have been developed for very specific situations in very specific hardware, like for example, a spacecraft with the hardware very, very under control. And what I want to do personally is to that this protocol can work in mostly any computer or mobile, because in time, what is going to happen is that people are going to need this kind of protocols if they go to space, if they go to travel to other planets, or if they go to live in other planets, and they are not going to have so specialized hardware. So that's our job now, to make this work in normal situations, in a computer with Windows, in a cell phone with Android or an iPhone, even in a BlackBerry, or in any kind of infrastructure that could be that is basically a computer and that could be used for this. Well, this is a brief story. We started last February. I wrote the draft about this. I'm going to share with this slide with you. So a lot of contribution for the several members. And this is a short background. We started conversations and I developed some ideas and things. What are the goals? This is important. One of the goals is the ease of usage, because as you have already installed Ion, for example, this is not easy. This is not for most, this is not for regular people. All of you are experts, are persons that know how to, but if you give this to your aunt, for example, or they are not going to be able to communicate in space in no way. So what we need to do, that these kind of things are easy for usage. We want also a global participation and awareness about ETN. Later, I'm going to share a newsletter about why I think that the global participation is very important all around the world. The configuration needs to be easy, needs to be multipoint. They could be needs to be office installation. All these topics, I think that are important. It's important to be adapted to different hardware, and the low hardware and connectivity requirements are important also. Well, this is a short brief of the development team. I've been for 30 years developing and deploying applications. I am an application developer of products. Just to show you, these are many years ago in 1998, I developed products in software, and these are products in also in medical records in software. What's the idea? Products are packaged things of software, of technology that people use. And I think that's very important. People use software products like they use anything that they go and buy or get for free, but they use that. Very specialist, like we are like to be a certain critical many times in the way we do things, but For things to be usable for person, they have to be easy and very, very available. And that's important. Well, in C programming, Dr. Bull worked with us. I made a lot of bash programming. Facundo, who is in the call, also he is a support manager at our company, and Daniela, they work together, they are brother and sister, have been working well. And other persons that had been in the manual development, the development of the manuals. I have some stats about it's around 2,000 lines of code in up to now, and we are going to set this Creative Commons license. That's the idea. It's a we have been talking with Dr. Bull for some months about this. We want to connect different environments. This is from space or university, corporate, enterprise, and residential. Another point important is the minimum hardware requirements. This is a computer that Facundo, for example, has at his home. And it's just a laptop, a very, very non-expensive laptop. And the implementation I'm going to describe, this has a back office system. Now we are going very specifically to the what we have developed up to now. Back office system. This is you have been working with ION, for example, and other technologies are not so different in terms of their interface. What I wanted to do is something more or less, this is not visual for now, but this is not, does not have a graphical units, graphical user interface for now, but the idea is that we're going to go to that later. But these are the points to configure most of the thing you already have done, but by typing. Isn't that true, Joshua? typing command. Well, we did like an old menu, an old menu topic. And a configuration, this is a configuration. I'm going to show this in operation now. Sharing my screen with that as well. With all what you have in the comments, well, you configure and it works. You test connectivity with multiple servers. This is, for you to be aware of this is bash scripting. This is bash scripting. This is not C, this is not another languages. This is basically bash, okay? This software also upload the results to one of my servers. My idea is that there are going to be several servers. And what we want to do with this, we want to get the information, all the results by a modification that that Dr. Bull developed, modifying the sources of in ION, we started storing these results in files instead of having them just on our screen. We started storing these results in files, and by that way, we upload the results and I develop a database that collects all the results. And these results we compare. We make a comparison between the result from different sources, different days. What does this system do? A very simple thing. It sends beepings, bundles from one endpoint to another, from one server to another and the other server response. Very easy, and in time we can add several other things, like sending a message, like sending a text, a file, or making a, like we are doing here, a video communication. We can do anything, but the idea was not only to connect but also to test what is going on. And the other point, interesting point, is that we try to, once this is installed, to make it work automatically, to make it work off with no hands, not touching it. So at this point, it is working on Linux, but I would love this to work in other operating system. And nowadays, we are making this work inside, for example, Windows, but with a virtual machine for now. We're using a virtual machine in VMware, but we could use other, there are several. We could use any other that's around. So even the system has the instructions the way of setting up the ground so it works automatically. And these are the results, the reporting of the results that are generated. Many other reports can be set up, but I built some just for testing. And these results are emailed. The idea is that they are emailed to the participants, so everybody knows what's going on with the job they are doing as a tester, okay? With reports, with graphics and all that. Well, Dr. Bull has set up an infrastructure that you are using for sure in Utica. And I'm not going to be extensive because you are there, so of the different infrastructure and clustering and the different servers and the connectivity. Well, finally, another topic, important topic is, and I'm going to share the link, is that this has a registration forms. This is for you to have an idea. The concept is that this is a structure as a product. This is not a structure as something like, but not a product because we sell that. A product because that's the only way that people, that we can get people to use it. It's not just a very technical thing. We want this to be usable for hobbies, for a person that would like to test the space DPN and all that. I think you lost the screen, but I'm going to share. I'm going to share the link now of the manual. This has a manual spreadsheet. I'm going nowhere. Let me see. Click. Let's see if you get that in the chat. Did you get?
Yes, it's in the chat, Oscar. Thank you.
Okay. There you have the manual in the chat. You can download it if you wish. This is a work in progress, but it's mostly set up. And we have a to-do list, like every software and product. We want to translate to different languages, different human languages, not. We want to incorporate several DTN implementations. We, as I said before, we want to. Are you? Can you see the presentation again?
Yes, we can see it.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. We want to add more testing functionality. For example, to connect to send different kind of messages. One of the topics important if we work. We want to work in dynamic IPs. I have been working on that it's not full working. To be clear, many things that I personally want to do were not thought from the beginning in these implementations, because they were thought for very specifically applications in spacecrafts in a very controlled environment. So, but if we want this technology to be more popular, to be more usable, we need to do that. We need to push the limits. That's what we are trying to do. Mobile environments generate wider statistics. I've been talking with Vinton Cerf about this statistic that you can see here. What else? Let's see. Okay. Finally, this is to do this. You can register here. You have the link there in the testing plan registration. I'm going to talk more about this. And Now, if you can, you click there, or I can share the.
Yeah, no, we can't click on that.
I just put the document in Engage in the course shell, so you guys can all download the PDF, and it should have the link in there, so you guys can start registering.
Okay, perfect, fantastic, thank you. This is my idea that I have. I don't know if I'm okay with the time, but I want to show you some real thing working, if you wish, and it would be great if you can register. And I have this idea with this. How many members, Ronnie, is the group now?
There's 5 students, and we have 20 minutes left of the class. So you have 20 minutes to do whatever you want with them, Oscar.
Okay, fantastic. Okay. Are you very bored, or are you sleeping?
No, I'm good.
Fantastic.
Okay.
Does anybody have any quick questions for Oscar on the presentation before we go into the practical stuff?
Nope.
Everything clear?
Everything was pretty clear. I think any questions that I might have had, I'll have to read that test, the plan going forward, were my questions.
Okay, fantastic. Okay, well, what we want to do is this process. I'm changing a bit of my screen now. Let's see if you can see that. The registration and all this is set up very simply. We can do better things in time, but at this first time we use Google Forms. And Facundo made a bit of Google scripting, of app scripting. So when you register, we are going to receive each one of even Ronnie are going to receive an email that we have a new registration, and you are going to receive, that's not automatically, but intentionally, not automatic. We're going to receive later an email for a second registration for more specification. Why is it done in 2 steps? Because what we want to do is that persons get enthusiastic about this, register, and then if you've put too many information in the first registration, most people just give up. Then we send a second email that has more what kind of server they have, if they have a personal computer or everything. After that, they receive a link to download the software. They receive a link on the email. We can do that also by downloading, for example, Ronnie has set up a GitHub. But my idea was that this could be done by people that don't even know how to use GitHub. It's not bad, but it's quite esoteric, this kind of things that they are great for people that like us, but not even for power users. I'm not talking about home users, but our users, persons that are used to work with computers. Most don't go to GitHub or SourceForge or things like that. So they get an email and they can download this software. I'm going to change now. One of the things that I would like, Ronnie, and that's something that we would need to talk, perhaps this group of students would like to help some of them as volunteers in following up with the newcomers and giving support to all these persons that might be interested in being part of the testing plan. That because some would have a Linux and others would not, and they would need to install a virtual machine. And sometimes those things go easy, and other times they are not. They are quite complicated. In the manual, there is an appendix with instructions about this. But well, we for experience we know that helping people makes things easier. Perhaps sometimes an email, a phone call, or whatever. I'm going to stop sharing this, and I'm going to share some screen, some operational screen. Let me see if I can. One second. I would like to share two screens, but I don't know if I can share all the screen. Can you share the full screen here in Zoom? All the screen?
You mean like your entire desktop background? You should be able
all,
to.
All. I don't know. Well, I'm going to share one and because different systems have different options. Can you see that?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, well, this is one of my server. This server is in Amazon Cloud. At this moment, I have two servers running in Amazon Cloud with DTN and two other servers. I have 34 servers running, not running all the time, but I have 34 instances in Amazon Cloud. In this moment, for this demonstration, there are two servers in Amazon Cloud with DTN and two other servers. That one is the public server that you can get websites and all that. And the other is a database server. So it's a stage in several, well, you know that. I'm going to show, this is the bash script is 2000 line, but it weighs 50 kilobytes. It's nothing. All the rest is ion installation and all that would can be quite heavy. For my experience, I've been testing, for example, some executables that were made by Ronnie, and I tested, they were compiled in Ubuntu, and I tested them in Red Hat, and they worked with some touching, for example, loaded libraries and all that I changed, but it worked pretty well. So my idea would be if we can, in time, set up like a package, an installable package that could be useful in most situations without much touching, without much development. Well, I'm going to show the configuration you have there. Are you watching? Can you see?
You can see this.
Okay. This is the configuration. I could modify, for example, I can change my EID, so bping and bpecho can have different service numbers. Because someone may be using also DTN for specific purposes. So the idea is that they could be part of the testing plan, but keeping operational. For example, if I have medical record for space, and I want to be part of the testing plan, the idea is that the system could do both at the same time, because I could be using a service to transfer medical records, but at the same time, I'm sending the pings to your server. You get the idea what I'm talking about? Okay. Port number, no number. If I'm not modifying anything, just to show you, the port name. With the port name, the system auto generates the information for to build the connectivity plan automatically. The system is building the connectivity plan by itself. This is uploading username, because the server that stores the database and the results of the testing is with a certain level of protection. So you have to you need to have a username and password that is given by the administrator. This is our case. And you can see there as well that there are three hosts, several host IP. Can you see that? Host 149, 150, 42. Can you see that? Okay. Well, you can, the system is designed that you can upload this by yourself, but I'm going to say that I'm not updating, but what the idea has been, I'm going to share another screen. Let me try. If we can go here. The idea is that there is an administration system. Let's see if I have it here. Oh, I'm not seeing it here. The administration system is, this is a back office, what is called a back office system. Let's see if it's in back. The back office system allows to, once you register, we are going to enter this registration in this back office system. What is that for? Because in that point we can know when the files are uploaded, who are the originator of that file, and also we can give a specific EID to each one of the members, or if they have a specific endpoint ID already. For example, I have a 149 and 150. Ronnie has 42. Other members have, well, and a new member just joins, the system is going to give them an endpoint identification. This is not really at this point like a DNS system, a full DNS system, but we are trying to implement this kind of DNS system, because at a certain point, you are not going to, you will need to identify, this is going to Utica College, this is going to Oscar servers, this is going to, so, okay, did you get the idea? And also, we are going to identify in this administration system which services, that is so-called TCP/IP ports, that are going to be used. If I'm going to be ping Joshua and Taylor is going to be ping me, I need to be listening in the right service, and Joshua needs to, I need to know what service I'm going to beep into Joshua. Okay, is that correct? I see Joshua and Taylor that in my screen, that's why I mentioned both of you. You get the idea. So centralized in some way or the other. Administration is going to be needed. Well, I thought I have this in my screen. I don't have it handy. It's going to be, but I wanted to show you that. So, are you getting more or less the idea of what we are talking about? Okay. And I'm going to stop sharing this, and I'm going to share again my screen. Let's see. Okay, are you watching again the TTI?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Perfect. So the system does some things. One is to get from these servers all the participant servers that are stored in the database up there, okay? In the cloud, in this case. But my idea is that we have replicated databases and systems, one in Utica. We have another idea of having one in Florida, one in Sweden, one in my servers, one in Amazon, one in cloud service in Azure. So, and I also want that all these databases that are MySQL can be replicated between them. So we are going to have a redundant system in that case, okay? From here I can do several things that you have been doing by hand, typing commands. Configure you already seen. In this case, I can see the host that I have. These are the several hosts. Okay, these hosts in this case have been downloaded from the server. And the system does another thing that is this builds an ion connectivity plan. You want to build a new connectivity plan now? Yes. So it guesses that you have been doing this by yourself. Okay, it gets information and cross all the contact with the other contacts. Basically, it's two loops, two loops in Bash, and across all the other each contact with one another, establish the connectivity, the range, all that you already know. Okay. And gets the external IP from all the other servers that are given by the central servers in this case, and gets the internal IP if it's different, maybe the same, but it could be different from the board, the Ethernet pole. Okay. Well, this is done. You can start. I'm not going to start ION now, because I could, but it's going to take more time. I can test a loopback. Okay, now it's loopbacking. Instead of typing, because I got tired of typing. I got tired of typing all these commands. So I say, I'm going to type a full system. It took me much more time than typing. Okay, it sends 20 beepings. And now I'm going to try, I can test BP echo as well. I'm going to try to, for example, to beeping. I'm going to beeping IPN 152.2. Okay, that is my other server in that is also running in the cloud, okay? This is 149, the one you're watching, and 152 is the other one. I can show you that one. But I'm going to try to do another thing now, that is, I'm going to ping Facundo's computer, that is that white computer that is connected to a cable in Argentina. And let's see if this works. So,
we are out of time, Oscar, so we'll have to do this and wrap it up.
Okay, I'm going to. Is it working? Well, in this case, it failed. No response. Well, this is what happens if and this is the important point of ETM. If this response is not happening, the packet is not lost. What happens is that I'm going to see if I can show you. Can you see there in my screen what says LPT block?
Yes.
Okay. The system automatically stored that block, and if the connection reappears, the ETM is going to send that bundle. Okay. That is the biggest difference that we have, on the greatest thing that we have between TCP/IP and DTM. Well, I need to wrap up. Our time is over. I don't know if we have some minutes for some questions. And well, I think the rest you are going going to be easy to understand for you. I'm going to.
So thank you very much, Oscar. This was very informative, and I'm sure everybody got a lot out of this. At this point, they've been doing all the manual creation of the contact plans. So this is, I'm sure a lot of them are looking at this like, oh, I wish you showed us this before, right? But you got to do the hard stuff first to understand it before you're given the automation.
That is the idea, I think.
Yeah, I was literally just thinking about that, Dr. Bull. I was like, I don't understand why he just didn't give us this to begin with, but...
Because you got to learn the underlying, you know, technology.
Yeah,
before you
can,
absolutely.
Especially if you want to participate at the expert level, right? So we have a meeting tomorrow in the morning, correct, Oscar?
Yes, absolutely. Yes, we have.
We have two students.
One idea that I wanted to share with you all now, after you have not got slept with my talk, I hope. One idea that perhaps we could set up. My idea is that if I have time on the weekend, I'm going to perhaps, Ronnie, if you have time, we can fix the things that licensing and all that we need to. And I would like to, I was thinking today, perhaps we could make Utica College as well as some other universities or some kind of educational institutions make the repositories of this code. What do you think that could be perhaps with an agreement or something like that that we could set up? Because I would like the students to keep working on that, but it would be good if it can be formally established. I don't hear. We don't hear.
And figure that out. I've assigned the students. They're going to have to, for this week, they're going to have to get their registration set up for the testing plan, download the bash script, and start contributing to the database. So making sure they're getting all that working by next Sunday. I hope everybody was just listening. So we will pick two students to join the meeting tomorrow morning, and we'll get back to you on that and send you the email, and then we will see you in the morning. But we really appreciate your time today, Oscar. And does anybody else have anything they want to ask or say to Oscar before we close out?
Thank you very much. That was really informative.
Thank you. I hope you have enjoyed.
We got a chat from Ryan saying thank you. He's at work right now, so he can't really do much speaking. He's been at a few of the meetings before with us, so you've met him. Okay, everyone. Well, thank you again for coming, and thank you guys all for participating, and we will see you tomorrow, Oscar. We also have a Nexus talk at the end of this month. Yep, so there is a Nexus talk at the end of this month. Going to be at Utica College. We're going to get more in depth with this stuff, so I'm encouraging all you guys to join that as well. Thank you.
All right, thanks Perfect. A lot, Oscar.
Okay, thank you. I hope to see your registration soon. Hope to see you on the spreadsheet.
Oh, okay. It's already sent.
Bye-bye.